After years on the road, a devastating car accident, and a couple of years apart, the Dells were back together and making strides. In 1961, after recruiting final member Johnny Carter, the Dells hit the road with the late jazz, R&B, and pop great Dinah Washington.
What a difference a day made.
And what a difference Dinah made to the Dells.
24 little hours.
Dinah Washington, the queen.
The sun and the flowers.
That woman was... Here's a woman that I liked her a whole lot, but then I couldn't stand her. Dinah Washington was a witch.
I wasn't afraid of her.
She would fire you. Okay, you're out of here. You're fired. Next day, we'd be to pack that stuff. How come you ain't in rehearsal? What you mean? You fired us. You've got 10 minutes to get. You know, that's just the kind of person she was.
Ain't these tears.
Dinah Washington may have driven them crazy, but they respected her talent and they learned.
She had a lot of talent. Dinah could sing a song and nobody play any music. And she'd be in a perfect key. She was something.
It was all an experience to make us grow.
She was tough. She was a good influence on us, you know, for as far as vocals and show business.
Dinah was rough. Dinah was a perfectionist. Dinah kept us under her wing for 2 years. It was like going to a male finishing school.
With Dinah Washington and through vocal coach Kirk Stewart, the Dells became jazz artists.
Jeepers creepers, where'd you get those hats?
You know, most people don't realize that the Dells can sing jazz as well as they can sing doo-wop.
Like the jazz things we did, we did the five parts. So as opposed to with the Flamingos, lead singer and four-part harmony. See, everything was like five instead of 4-1.
What we did with jazz, we did something that people used to say, you know, they didn't expect that to come out of us.
One jazz performance highlight.
Anybody from the jazz era knows it's Four Freshmen are strictly jazz.
And the biggest thrill I ever had was the Four Freshmen came to us and talked to us after the show.
We had just killed the artists. It's like 18,000 people there and they're just applauding, clapping or whatever.
They thought we was heavyweight musicians out there singing that, you know.
And the guy from the freshman comes up to us and says, man, you guys are fantastic. Where'd you guys learn all that wonderful harmony, the jazz thing, blah? He said, we studied at Juilliard and got our degrees and the whole bit. He said, where'd you guys get your degree? We said, well, the ice cream parlor, 147th and Roby and Harvey.
After touring with Dinah Washington, the Dells were recommended as an opening act to another legend, the late Ray Charles. The year was 1966.
The man was like in the military. You get on the plane, you'd have roll call.
Ray Charles was an honor cat. You never got a chance to talk to Ray.
His road manager, those who have seen the movie, see this guy that comes in, he's a real hard knob. Ray took us to Carnegie Hall in New York. Well, lo and behold, the Dells go out there and just kill the house.
We had like five standing ovations.
They didn't quite like that too well.
So the next night, Ray Charles, road manager, told us, when do you guys want to leave the show? Because we're going to be in Peoria next tomorrow.
They came back and told us, said, well, where do you want us to drop you off at?
Fired us, because we got a standing ovation.
We couldn't believe that we were being fired. This is before Donald Trump.
But the guys give Ray Charles credit because the star later congratulated them in person after they started to hit it big. The Dells charted with 40-plus hits in their career, beginning in 1967 with one of the many hits written by Bobby Miller called There Is. Miller also wrote one of their top sellers, which hit for the second time in 1968 and pushed their career into the stratosphere.
If you stay, stay, darling.
Stay in my corner.
And interestingly, they almost didn't re-record it.
The only reason Stay in My Corner got on the album, we literally needed another song to fill the album.
So we suggested him, let's sing Stay in My Corner.
People just love Stay in My Corner, especially when Marvin started adding that long note.
When we got to it, we still were short of time. I told him, well, I'll tell you what, I'll do a long note.
And a long note he did.
He holds the note sometimes so long, we need to go over there to the Marvin, you start holding the note, let it go.
He held the note for 2 minutes. And I said, breathe, man, you're gonna die. Oh.
That was the first longest playing single in history. The DJs had a chance to go home, eat lunch, meet their wives, play with the kids, get back in the car, come back to the studio.
That's their part of the song. I never knew that when we did that, it was going to be that big, but they loved that long note.
At the time, Stay in My Corner sold more than 4 million records and was followed shortly thereafter by another re-release.
Oh, what a lie.
Oh, What a Night, written by Johnny Funches and Marvin Jr., was inspired by a post-performance party with 5 female fans.
They liked the way we sing, and hey, what can I say? So they invited us over to their house. They lived in the city. And we went down to their party, and they had fried chicken. And they had it all laid out. They even had whiskey and beer. And boy, we had a ball.
Oh, man, Over the Night. Man, we had a great time.
So the next day we were saying, man, what a party. Boy, what a party. And Johnny said, oh, what a night. I said, say that again. He said, oh, what a night. I said, I love you, dear. And we wrote Over the Night.
Oh, What a Night hit number 4 when it was first released in 1956 and was an even bigger hit when it was released again in 1969, climbing to number 1 on the R&B chart and number 10 on the pop charts. The 69 version was arranged by Charles Stepney, Adele's mainstay, who went on to work with Earth, Wind & Fire. Stepney worked on several hits, including the 1971 topper, The Love We Had Stays on My Mind. For
once I feel my... Johnny sets it up. Marvin comes in. He's inspirational, you know.
Larry Wade wrote The Love We Had with Terry Collier.
It was basically in part of everything that we were saying about our infidelity, so to speak, which I'm